So I'm back here with Nick and Rory. So I've had Parkinson's for 7 years. You've had it for, I think, slightly less.
Mm-hmm. 5 years and more, slightly less.
I've four.
4 years. Mm-hmm. So in that time, we've all spoken to a lot of experts, I think, about sort of therapies and research and so on. But the feeling I have is that since I was diagnosed, nothing really has changed. There's no new therapies available. And we're always perennially 5 years away from a...
Here it's 5 years away and has been for 25 years.
So... do you think the scientific community is overly optimistic about the actual pace of research?
I don't know that they're over... I think they're sometimes too close to it, too excited about just the process of discovery to tell the truth to people, which is that it's a hell of a long way away.
What do you mean by cure anyway?
Well, that's
an interesting point, because it's not necessarily about finding a cure. I think it's also about just finding... better therapies that prolong your useful life.
So. The definition they use is slow, stop, or reverse. Obviously, reverse being the kind of holy
grail. Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, there are two drugs, I think, in stage three trials, which we should be pretty optimistic about.
So, exenatide is one of them, which is the cure of Parkinson's.
And, oh, what's the other one? Cough, Ambroxol.
Well, for me, so cell replacement sounds quite promising in the sense that it doesn't change the progression of the disease, but if I can replace the cells that aren't working, either grow new ones or transplant them in, which is what a number of trials are looking at the moment, and if that buys me 20 years of being able to move normally, I think that's quite a good result.
That is exciting, and we're going to do a whole episode on it in series three of Movers and Shakers. But I have to say, I went to a brilliant presentation by Roger Barker, the Cambridge prof who is the leader of this, and when he said, you know, he'd been working on this since the 1980s. My heart sank.
Fell through the floor.
Yeah, because they've been very excited at certain stages over that whole period.
What do you think is the root cause of why we haven't found good therapies for Parkinson's yet? Is it enough funding? Is it enough visibility?
Well, there certainly isn't much funding. 6.7 million quid put in by central government in the most recent year. I mean... What can you buy with under 7 million quid?
So I read somewhere that HIV/AIDS had a total of $500 billion of funding to get to the antiretroviral therapies we have today.
Quite.
Yeah.
But that has eliminated HIV.
Yeah.
For all intents and purposes.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if Parkinson's had that much spent on it, I mean, there hasn't been that much progress made since 1968.
No.
Not in terms of actual... I mean, I think the scientists will tell you they've made a lot of progress in all sorts of areas. But in terms of actual therapies for patients. Mm, So funding is clearly one aspect.
I've been doing stuff about this US plan to end Parkinson's, which is a sort of measure going through Congress. And they've taken inspiration from something similar with Alzheimer's. When something similar happened with Alzheimer's, funding for Alzheimer's research absolutely... went stratospheric. They're getting $3.5 billion a year out of the US government. And the hope is that a similar project for Parkinson's will massively increase funding there.
And there's a business case for it, isn't there? Because I stopped work at least 5 years sooner than I would have done if I hadn't had Parkinson's, and I'm not paying taxes on that income. And I struggle to do things that I cost the government a lot in terms of medication. So a lot of people have talked about a sort of Parkinson's charter. What would that involve and how would that help?
Oh, well, we'll tell you that when we've decided it. We are, as movers and shakers, trying to come up with a charter.
Just coming back to scientific research and new therapies, is there enough urgency? I get the sense that science sort of plods along quite slowly and we do these clinical trials, they take a long time.
I'm outraged by how long it takes to do a clinical trial. And what a big gap there is between phase two and phase three. It's kind of, what should we do now? But I know you're involved in, there's this sort of plan for this multi-arm trial, which would be much faster and would where you'd be able to switch horses as one drug failed and a new promising one would come in. And that has got to be a good idea.
It certainly makes sense. So what can we do as people with Parkinson's and people watching this video?
We can shout about
it. What
can
we do to push things along?
We can make a fuss.
To who though?
Well, to our politicians. What they've done in America with this US plan to end Parkinson's was they've sent out what they call patient advocates, people with Parkinson's, have seen more than half the members of Congress.
So they lobby the
Yeah.
Do you know how many people, in members of Parliament, that's in both houses, are admitted with Parkinson's? None.
Okay.
Zero. We have no voice in Parliament at all.
Of course.
You would have thought in the House of Lords there'd be quite a few, wouldn't you?
Yeah, well, obviously are.
Maybe they're hiding.
Drooling and shaking, but they're not. They haven't admitted to having Parkinson's.
Mm.
There is not one in Parliament who is an acknowledged Parkinson's.
Right. Well, maybe that's a new idea, Judge. Why don't we stand for Parliament?
No, well, I think, actually, without joking, I think there's a case for at least one of us becoming a peer.
Yeah.
Right.
You even can become a peer.
look at the ones you've got there. Can't be that fit. It's not as if you're joining a very
UK new career goal.
Can I give a little shout out for a new charity that is coming onto the block, which I am going to be involved with, which is Professor Chowdhury's charity, which is focusing on his particular concern, which are the non-motor symptoms, or the bottom of the iceberg, you know, all that 8/10 of the existence that aren't seen by anybody, which aren't the trim, you know, which are all the sleep disorders. Don't get me started on that. How long have you got? The sleep disorders, the drooling, the constipation, the embarrassing bits, the stress, the anxiety, all the things that are below the iceberg, which is the first thing he wants to concentrate on, and that's in fact how I got friendly with him, was when we raised all that money for his research and that, but it's become charitabilized now. And the second aspect of the charity is a very good thing, which is to standardize diagnostic techniques throughout the country so that the same evidence is being used, so that proper statistics can be drawn up as to what people's symptoms are, and standardized diagnostics means standardized treatment.
Sounds wonderful. I mean, you make a couple of very good points there. One is that the non-motor symptoms can actually affect people much more than the motor symptoms in terms of their daily lives.
Yes.
In terms of what makes things difficult for us. Uh-huh. And you make another good point, which is Parkinson's is a highly individual disease. It varies enormously between people in terms of the symptoms and the progression. But we compound that problem by every neurologist having their own take on it. Well, my personal slightly pessimistic view is that we really don't fundamentally understand what Parkinson's is at the moment. We know it's something to do with alpha synuclein. We know bits of the jigsaw, but we don't know how to assemble the picture. And until we do that, I think we're slightly shooting in the dark in terms of just guessing at drugs that might make a difference. Mm. And I think we're 30 years away from actually curing Parkinson's and really understanding. In the interim, I think we can do a lot to sort of alleviate some of the life problems. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you, Rory. Thank you, Nick.
Great pleasure.
It's been a great pleasure to talk to you.
Great pleasure. Thank you very much. A great pleasure.